forth a flame rule. Summertide. I write these words in the event our prayers to Umberlee go unheard. I write these words in the event our offerings don't drift along the currents and land in the treasury of Umberlee's palace. I write these words because they may very well be my last. A great storm has caught us in its grasp, like a kraken's powerful tentacle, and won't let go. Our ship, the Bitch Queen, is taking on water. Several of the crew have already been claimed by the sea when massive black waves, like rolling hills, swept over the deck and dragged them away screaming. While everyone else works to try and take control of the situation, here I remain, in my cabin, like a coward. I want there to be a record of what happens to us, so people know how we met our end. It was the captain's idea to proceed into the storm on the horizon. As a cleric of Umberlee, Doris Goals told her crew that we had nothing to fear, that the Wave Mother was on our side, and that this wasn't our time to die. She was wrong, though. Her confidence was too much, as if the ocean itself were her ally. She must have been blinded by the salty spray of the sea, and now blind to the new reality. We are going to die. She's outside my cabin now, banging on the door, telling me she'll kill me slowly if I don't face my fears like a true sailor. She's right. Might as well go down trying to thwart the Bitch Queen's attempts to drag us down to the dark abyss. Here I come, Death. When I see your face, I shall spit in it one last time in defiance. Here I come. Have at thee! Fifth of Flame Rule. We are alive. Unless this is the afterlife. Wouldn't mind it if that were true. 'Tis a beautiful land, unlike any I've seen before. Untouched and uncorrupted by man. Perfection. There are 8 of us now. About to be 7. Doris and I never even made it to the top deck before the Bitch Queen was capsized by what must have been a rogue wave. The hull began spinning as we tumbled along with it, hitting the walls and roof. Water began to pour in and pushed into the back wall of the ship. Hard. The captain was knocked unconscious, forcing me to be the one to save her, along with the others lucky enough to ride the wave through the ship. We stayed alive by finding an air pocket in the ship's hold. Had to watch the water level rise quicker and quicker. A slow death, I thought. Unavoidable, apparently. That's when we heard it. A horn blowing in the distance. Minutes later, and just in time, a turtle man emerged from the water. Our surprise was apparent, for we had never seen anything like them before. When he told us he was here to help, though, we gladly accepted. Never look a gift seahorse in the mouth. Several of these turtles took us to the nearby beach, saving our lives. I've gotta say, I may never go into the ocean again after that. Why tempt fate? The great queen of the sea is probably waiting for us underneath those churning waves, daring us to sail her waters again, just so she can drag us into the depths. She'll be waiting a long, long time. Fifth of Flame Rule, second entry. The Snout of Omgar is the name of this beautiful land. A land inhabited by turtles, a peaceful folk. They find beauty and peace in everything they do. Makes me a bit jealous, I admit. They are also a hardy people, fighting for their way of life to make sure it doesn't change. And yet here we are, the first foreigners to ever set foot on their lands. I feel like their whole world is about to be turned upside down. Doris is already regaling them with tales of Umberlee's power and glory, painting a beautiful picture of her goddess in their minds, all while leaving out her less desirable traits. Her wrath and her never-ending obsession to drag all life she can under the waves. If only they knew the truth. Yet I don't dare expose her. Doris would have my head within seconds. Instead, I'll just mind my own. Stories are just stories, after all. What harm could they bring? Fifth of Flame Rule, third entry. The brave and mighty turtle, Gumdar, the one who witnessed the wreck, blew the horn, and saved our lives, has brought us to their fort, which keeps them safe from the dangers of the island. They call this place Ahoyhoy. Beautiful and peaceful. While the villagers remain appropriately cautious of us, they have still shown a level of hospitality I've never seen before. They're allowing us to stay with them in one of their seaside dwellings. They fed us a wonderful meal of cooked fish, diced vegetables, and endless platters of exotic fruits. I could get used to this. 7th of Flame Rule. I've made a new friend. His name is Ubo, an elderly turtle. Apparently one of the few turtles to ever leave home, and the only one on the island that worships a god. The god Eldath, a peaceful mother to druids, has found her way into Ubo's heart and soul. Apparently, turtles don't worship their own gods, but instead, they find the meaning and power of religion in the divinity in other races. The few turtles he's met off the island have found comfort in the arms of Sunu, under the branches of Sylvanas, and even the light of Lathander. While this is indeed interesting news, I find myself worried for these peaceful minds as Doris continues to spin tales of how wonderful Umberlee is. The turtles find her enthralling, and I'm beginning to worry what may come next. Ubo and I are sitting on his back porch, which is also a deck that hangs over the Cerulean Sea. Both of us have cast our lines and await for the fish to bite. To pass the time, we've been telling each other jokes and stories, all while drinking his favorite tea, something made with fruits and spices. It's actually pretty good. His jokes, however, aren't quite as good. Takes him forever to get to the punchlines. I mean, he's literally been telling the same joke for 5 minutes. Actually, now that I think about it, maybe he's telling a story. Either way, it doesn't matter. There's nowhere else I'd rather be. Can't remember the last time I felt this relaxed. So at peace here. Oh, apparently he was telling a joke. The punchline. It was the wrong hermit crab shell. I don't get it. 13th of Flame Rule. It's as I feared. The turtles are now building a palace in the name of Umberlee. They call it Dengwaru, which loosely translates to High Home. Doris doesn't speak the Aquan tongue, so she's nicknamed it the Typhoon Palace. I'm beginning to see how this will all play out. She's going to become the ruler of this island. I should have the courage to stop this, but I know what she'd do to me. And I'm scared. I can tell some of the other crew are having to bite back their tongues as well. Korv and Luca keep casting each other worried glances the more Doris speaks. Piece by piece, this palace is going to be built, no matter how much we disapprove. 11th of Myrtle, the Melting. It's been almost a year since the crew of the Bitch Queen has arrived on these shores. It's been a long time since I put quill to paper. Didn't need to, for I became distracted. I found love. One of the other crew, Sela, asked to go with Ubo and I on a short boat trip around the island. She seemed bored, so I brought her with us. Three of us to one canoe and enough supplies for a 2-week trip. It was fun. Camped on the coast, stayed up late telling stories, and even made friends with a small group of geonids. Was worried that little rock goblins were going to attack us, but Ubo used some kind of spell to calm them down. They gave us shelter in one of their caves while we rode out the storm. Sela began to have flashbacks of the storm that brought us to this island, and became frightened. Until I wrapped my arm around her. You're not the only one who can calm emotions, Ubo. 13th of Myrtle, first entry. Construction of the Typhoon Palace is now complete. I cannot believe what the turtles were able to accomplish in the time they spent on this. They can move so unbelievably fast when they want to. I do have to say it is impressive, but also a huge waste of time and effort. Umberlee does not deserve this kind of love and attention. It pains me to see how devoted the turtles have become to the Queen of the Depths. And to Doris. They're treating her as a queen as well. They're treating us all well, but I'm beginning to feel even more guilty than ever. I could have stopped all of this if I'd spoken up all that time ago, but I didn't. I think I finally need to tell someone. Ubo will listen. 13th of Myrtle, second entry. Ubo is gone. He left this morning for a long journey to the mainland. I didn't tell him anything. I couldn't. I chickened out again. The words got caught in my throat and said all I could say was, "Good luck, friend." Somehow I knew that it would be the last time I'd see him. Ubo, the best friend I ever had. 14th of Myrtle. Sella came to visit last night. After a bit of tossing and turning, we just laid there, silently listening to the sound of the waves as they rushed over the white sandy beach over and over again. She fell asleep quickly, while my mind couldn't rest. I walked out to the beach and stared into the ocean, the moon illuminating the waters. I miss my friend. 16th of Myrtle. I finally visited Dangwaru today. For the first time, I opened its doors and walked its halls. I was so impressed with the architecture. It was completely different than what the turtles had built in Ahoyhoy. The doors had Umberlee's symbol, crashing waves, carved into the front of each one. The walls were different colors of blues and greens with colorful coral branches, shells, starfish, stones, and the bones of various sea life. Beautiful mosaics of even more colorful stones and shells brought underwater imagery to life in the forms of sharks, octopuses, and schools of fish. Statues of sharks, crabs, and krakens were scattered around, as well as Umberlee depicted in her many forms. Plants filled every room, from palm trees to ferns, and even dry coral. Driftwood carvings were placed neatly and purposefully in every corner. Paintings on the walls and urns continued this underwater theme. The furniture was made of the best materials the turtles could find on the island. I was completely transfixed by what I saw while I walked through these echoing sunlit halls. I stepped out into the garden, beautiful and lush, multi-tiered and overlooking the ocean. Utterly beautiful. Breathtaking. Until I saw her. Doris was laying in the gazebo being attended to by several turtles. One trimmed her nails, while another washed her hair, and the last fanning her with a large palm leaf. A line of turtles patiently waited to present her with gifts, carvings made from driftwood, jewelry of coral, shells, and geonid gemstones, fruity alcoholic drinks, and clothing in every color of the rainbow. The sight sickened me. So I left. 18th of Myrtle, first entry. Doris can no longer get away with brainwashing the turtles of the Snout of Omgar. We won't let her continue her reign as the self-proclaimed queen of the island. She has become the new bitch queen. Well, this queen is about to lose her throne. Korv, Luca, Sella, and I are going to confront her soon. Let's hope all goes well. 18th of Myrtle, second entry. It's done, I think. We found our old captain in the crab pools within the decorated halls of the Typhoon Palace. We hoped to catch her off guard, but even as she bathed, completely exposed, she didn't give an inch in her new role as ruler. She spoke down to us as though we were peasants, laughing at our accusations, all while swarms of crabs cleaned the dirt and grime away from her body. She rose out of the water, dripping with confidence and showing no fear or retreat, even in this state. That's when we had to take it to extreme measures. All of us drew our weapons, which instantly changed her mood. She began shouting at us, threatening that if any harm came to her, her minions would feed us to the sharks below the garden's high walls. We forced her back with a threat of our own. If she doesn't stop this madness, we'll kill her right here, right now. And tell the turtles what she's been doing to them. That seemed to shut her up. I'm going to tell the turtles the truth tonight regardless. 18th of Myrtle. third entry. Doris Gulls, the bitch queen. I'm going to come to kill you tonight. I'm going to kill you tonight. And I'm going to make it slow and painful. Last night, as the sun went down, Corv, Luca, Sella, and I gathered in our seaside hut to prepare our speech to the turtles of Ahoyhoy. I left early to tell the villagers to gather at the amphitheater tonight for something very important. That's when it happened. A random wave of unexpected size crashed into my home and dragged it into the sea. Despite our efforts, there were no survivors. My Sella. My love. To see her lifeless was more than I could bear. I wept tears for her, as salty as the ocean spray that continuously coated me as I held onto her body. The sadness I felt, however, quickly turned into something else. Wrath. The turtles were convinced that it was just a natural accident. They said the ocean can be unforgiving, as is Umberly, they said. I had enough at that point. I tried telling them the truth about everything, but they wouldn't have it. Some even grew angry. They asked how I could dare speak that way about the goddess of oceans. Others calmed them down, saying that I was simply lashing out in my grief. I quickly walked away with a new goal in mind. To kill Doris. The turtles would hate me for it, but I knew I was doing them a favor. I know Doris sent that wave. As a cleric of Umberly, it was absolutely within her power to do so. Here I come, Doris. Here I come to bring the justice that should have come a long time ago. No longer do I feel fear. I write these words in the event I do not live through this. I write these words as if they were my very last, just in case. I would like someone to know the truth. This has been the Journal of Siburath.